All right. So I'll start off. So I thought what I would do is I'm going to ask you two questions.
Sure.
The first question is, what is it that you believe that most people already know about him? Let's do that.
Okay.
And then the next question is going to be, what is it that you wish they knew? Let's do the first one.
Well, and Diego, thank you very much. As you can tell, Diego really likes doing this interview. I always thought that he should be a talk show host, and maybe in the future, because he's not making any money now being a state rep,
right.
you're going to have to get a job.
I've got a face for radio.
But thank you, Diego, for everything. And I want to acknowledge, my nephew Henry is here, and my nieces Yvette and Bilal. And so, again, so you have some Gonzalez members here. And I'm almost embarrassed to throw it out there, but the truth is, the one thing that people always talk about, what do y'all think?
Earl Abels.
Earl Abels. And there was, your dad or Congressman, he punched that guy out. Well, that wasn't the only thing my father did in his career, as you know. But it's something that was very symbolic for people. Now, was he right, wrong doing it, you know? As lawyers, we would say you don't do that, right?
I enjoyed it, actually.
but I think that his independent spirit, I think they all, and of course, you know, hemisphere and things like that. And in the early days, the segregation bills that he filibustered, and then when he was in Congress, many of the things that he did that maybe weren't as sexy and such, but you know, the savings and loan debacle and the meltdown and what it cost the United States, affordable housing, all of that, and of course some of his resolutions of impeachment on like George Bush, the first George Bush and such. So those are some of the things, but I think overall, I think they just look at his independent spirit and that he was a real fighter and that he related to his constituents. The most important thing in his life would be his constituents, and that he never was really absorbed by Washington. He never became part of Washington. He came home every weekend, and in those days, that was unheard of. Now, everyone does that for a lot of reasons, because they have to raise money to run for office, and they have to go home a lot more often. So I think that's what they remember.
The relationship with constituents, you know, I believe, is sort of a calling card or a hallmark. But as someone who's served on the local level and now at the state level, you know, I find myself grappling with doing what I consider real work and then other things that I call being a show pony, right? And I've tried not to do the show pony stuff. And I think that the connection with constituents, if it's real and genuine as I really believe it was unique. What did he do? What did he do that made him so beloved by the folks he represented? It wasn't that they liked him or they had confidence in him, but they loved this man. I have a story. You've heard this story, but I have a story about that. But people loved this
Excuse
man.
Excuse me. Yeah, but you need to speak up quite a bit more.
All right. How about this? I will speak up, and then if you're in the back, let's move up so I'm not yelling, because we don't have microphones.
Yeah.
Let's do both. If anyone can hear us in the back. So what is it about that relationship with the community that made him so beloved? What did he do? And I'm just going to put it out there. Now, I have a philosophy that if as an elected person, you're spending a lot of your time doing ribbon cuttings and groundbreakings and the openings of businesses, that's not really work. Maybe it's work to get reelected, but it's not really, you're not really advancing an agenda. You're not really representing people. You're not fighting for them. And so when that's all you do, people know you and respect you, but they don't really care for you the way that they cared for your dad. What did he do that generated that kind of connection?
I think he spent time with people, and he took time with people. I always found it extraordinary because when I was in public office, as you know, there are only so many hours in a day, but he would take as long as it was necessary to listen to somebody, genuinely listen, and then act on it. You weren't forgotten if you approached him. Well, first of all, he was going to remember your name, your address, your phone number. He didn't even have to write it down. The story I always tell is when I was running and somebody would come up and they'd say, "We were for your father, we're going to be with you." And so I had my little pad and you would, "What is your name?" And they'd look at me, And that's, and they said, well, it's Arturo Saldivar, and so, and they look at me, and I thought, what's wrong? I said, and I looked, and they said, your father never had to write it down. And so, so that's the thing, is that you run into that issue. But he genuinely cared, Diego. I mean, it was so sincere. Now, the other thing, too, is that he sought people out. People came to him, but he was very proactive. And I'll give you examples of, if Dad went to a banquet, we're talking about ribbon cuttings and banquets and going, and you know, where he started, when he would go to a banquet, he started greeting people in the kitchen and the waitstaff. He always made sure that's who he talked to. And sometimes people that were sponsoring an event weren't too crazy about that because it added time and it delayed the process. That's what he was going to do. If he was going to go to the Express News or back then San Antonio Light to be interviewed by the editorial board, he insisted he was going to go to that those back rooms and where the presses were and everything. Because that's the people that he really felt comfortable with. Now that's the other thing too, is I think Dad had a comfort zone that would lend itself much more to the average constituent citizen. And maybe that's what he felt he could make a real difference in their lives, because they probably needed the greatest improvement or had the greatest needs.
So I want to give you guys my own personal example of what this looks like. And despite my youthful appearance, I turn 40 in a couple weeks, so I'm old enough. So there was one weekend where my mom and I, who rode the bus, she said, I'm going to take you to a birthday party. There's a very important man who's having a birthday party outside. So we hopped on the bus, and we ended up, I think it was San Pedro Park. And she walks me around. There's this nice older guy who she says hello to, and she talks to him for, you know, a longer period of time than men usually talk to my single mom. I was like, who's this guy? Why are they talking? What's going on? You know? And then he leaned over and shook my hand, and they talked again. I said, okay, and then I think I had some Big Red and cake. And we rode the bus back, and I didn't think much of it. And so then you fast forward maybe 2 or 3 weeks. I'm in my room, I don't know, and my mom comes into my room and says, there's a package for you. And the mailman, this is back when you had the same mailman for decades. So we knew him, we always leave cookies out for him and milk on Christmas or the holidays. Just the mailman wants to come inside and watch you open this package, which is weird, right? So I come out of my room and he's already standing in the house, which is really weird. And there's a mail envelope waiting for me. I don't know if I have my name on it because I couldn't read. But I opened it, and it was a calendar from your dad, which is cool. It was cool to get a calendar. But what I remembered, even as a kid, was there something about whoever sent me this calendar that meant so much to our mailman that he wanted to watch this kid open it and wondered why this kid was getting mail from this person. Does that make sense? And that's when I really knew that it wasn't just that they liked him or they respected him. It wasn't that you know, he was sort of the elected rep for the area. It's that he meant so much more to them that someone would want to sort of break the sort of societal protocols and ask themselves into a house to watch some mocoso open up a package. There's something really special about that. Now, as a congressperson, just like a state rep, if you've got an issue, we want to help, but it's hard to snap our fingers and make it happen, right? And so if you're really trying to help people with their problems, sometimes you have to sort of work your way around other, like, people, the city government, the county government. How did he manage that, getting things done? Did he have relationships everywhere where he could make a phone call and call the city council person or call the county commissioner because there was someone that needed help with something that, he, as a congressperson, he couldn't do, but that had to happen?
And now, and Dad's career, of course, started before 1961 when he got elected to the Congress. And here, Gene Rodriguez is here, who was a young college student who worked for Dad, who wrote his master's thesis on my father that covered a period up to about, what, 1960? About 65. So that was all those early years, late 40s through the 50s. And what was consistent, even when he went off to Congress, was exactly what you're talking about, is that, one, people would know that he would not forget them and that he would respond. Nothing was worse than not answering my father's inquiry if you worked for an agency or a department, because he expected that was your job. If it was the VA, Social Security, Immigration, that's your job. You're supposed to get me an answer. You're supposed to tell me, you know, where Mrs. Sanchez's application is in this process. You haven't told her, but you're going to tell me. Because if you didn't, my father would take you to task on it. And he went to the very top. I mean, you know, their supervisor stuff, but he would just go to the department, you know, department head or agency head and say, look, I sent this letter of inquiry. I haven't got a response. I have followed up. One thing my father did not let the bureaucracy do is wait or wear you out, which happens often because they're overburdened and such. And sometimes you just don't have people that take your job the way they should. So it was the follow-up. And Dad had great staff. And Diego, you're learning that too. All of us know that we're only as good as the individuals that work in that office, because he couldn't do it all himself. And he worked everybody hard. And he was going to respond. I don't know if he could survive in today's environment, but even when we were kids, or the neat thing was when you finally got a driver's license because you could drive. And the downside was, when Dad would come in, they would deliver. He would have boxes of mail at 10 o'clock at night, and he would start reading every letter and signing them and putting P.S.'s on them and everything. Then around 2 in the morning, he'd say, take them to the post office. So, you know, and you had a car, so you had to. And you're going, what does it matter? You know, if we take them now, because you go downtown, remember the big post office, and you just shove stuff in there at all hours. What did it matter? But to Dad, you know, he wanted that to be there as soon as possible. If it meant one day delay, it was there. So I think it just, everything he did, Diego, I think translated to giving that person that secure feeling that he was not going to let you down. And he took it personally. He took it personally. I guess it's the best way to explain it.
Well, I'm going to ask a personal question.
Sure.
If you've got this man, a great man, who's beloved, you know, by the city he's in, the people of that city, and he demands excellence, and he's a taskmaster, right? He wants people to do their job and fulfill their responsibilities, and he's not in town all the time, at least in that phase. What's that like when that's your dad?
Well, you know, it's difficult, and that's why, and my mother never got much credit for anything, but if it wasn't for Mom, Dad wouldn't have had any success at all, because it's what Diego was telling you. He was gone all the time. When we were younger, and I'm thinking of, you know, Pilar's dad, Henry Jr., and Beva, my sister, Yvette's dad, a mom. And when we were younger, I mean, he just came in, went out, came out. He was just on the go all the time. And so when we would meet people, they would go, oh, your father, he was at my daughter's wedding. Oh, he threw out the first baseball. Or he was at a baptism. And we always would go, so that's where he was. And so it was a real sacrifice. And I think to be a total dedicated servant, public servant, there's sacrifice. And any family that tells you that there's not, something's wrong. And it's not that other jobs aren't going to take you away from your family, but you know, it's not like being in the service where, you know, you're shipped out and you're gone for it. That, you understand that concept. But what if someone is supposed to be living in that house and you hardly see him? And then when he went to Congress, well, that was it. Because you know, he would leave on a Sunday, come back on a Thursday or a Friday. Just all the time. And so it's, you know, it wasn't I think it was real hard on the family, and he was never on time. He was never on time for the family. Gene, you remember. The big thing was that Dad was going to take us camping, for instance, to Frank Modler's ranch, Frank Modler Sr., out in Helotes. And man, and Dad was wonderful about it. And so let's say we're supposed to leave at 5 o'clock. And so you'd be out there with your friends, because he would let you bring a couple of friends. We'd have our camping gear. Well, you know, what time we'd get out to Motla's? 10 at night. And so, I mean, and he'd have the car lights so that we could set up our camp and stuff. So it takes a lot of sacrifice. But I think you also understand that people are just counting on him, and he needs your support. And whether you're there supporting him every day, or you just, you know, kind of tolerate things, you've got to be supportive one way or another. And I always tell, and we've had our talks and everything, and I sat down with Joaquin and I told him, look, Washington can do things. You know, you will neglect your family. And so if people say, are you saying your father neglected the family? And the answer is, well, of course he did, because he couldn't create time, right? And he made up, you know, he made up for many things, but it's pretty tough. And as far as, now we'll tell you, as you reach your teenage years, and your dad and your poor mom, you have 7 brothers and sisters, and she can't corral everybody, and your dad's gone a lot. I had a lot of fun as a teenager. So.
We'll do an after hours version of this talk. So I want to follow that trail to talk about, given that, and given your perch and watching all that, what in God's name do you want to do it? But I want to ask a two-parted question about your dad's work. I mean, as you can imagine, that's one of the things that I'm most interested in. You know, the family sacrifice feast, you know, I got married not too long ago, so we're figuring that out, but I'm not nearly as busy as he was. So we sort of went through what people may know him for, what you wish they knew him for. But let's say that, you know, I think when you're in any position and you're dealing with people, there are things that you're known for doing, but those may not be the biggest wins to you personally, right? There might be something that gets you into the paper or a lot of fanfare or gets you headlines, but those may not be the accomplishments or the wins that mean the most to you personally. If we were to ask him, like, what of the things that you've done are you most proud of? I think that we have an instinct of what our answer would be, but what would his answer be? What were the things that he did that he felt most proud of, that he fulfilled his purpose as a servant?
Well, on one hand, because I remember Dad always saying that he always wanted to be part of the legislative branch, because policy into law could impact so many people all at once. The problem was to make sure that the law was carried out and, you know, its goal was met and such. But deep down, I always thought Dad's greatest gratification was when people came up and said, you made a difference in my life. You know, you brought my son home from Vietnam for the funeral, and things like that. Or you were able to get that visa. Oh, you got my dad into the VA when they were giving him a hard time. I think that just, it fed his spirit. And that's not to say, Diego, and we're all built the same way. We want to be part of something really big that does get publicized to show that we're making a difference to an entire population. But his big thing, I think it was the individual. And if you look at big accomplishments and such, I would say a lot of the things that he would be the most proud of, he didn't succeed at. We were interviewing somebody in Washington 2 weeks ago that worked for Dad in the 50s. When he was a law student, this young man, he's probably 75 now, but he was a law student in Austin, and Dad was in the state Senate. And so we always talk about the filibusters against the segregation bills and all those things, and Dad being the first Mexican-American elected state senator, all those things. But then Richard said, oh man, but you know, where we had the greatest fun was introducing bills that we knew were never going to pass because they were so controversial and so far ahead of the time. And so we said, well, like what? Well, your dad introduced a minimum wage bill in the state Senate in the 50s.
Wow.
You know, it was 45 cents an hour or something like that. But I mean, the whole thing is, to be honest with you, that's right, but I'd forgotten.
Right.
But those are the things that he just loved, tossing that stuff out there and getting the conversation, knowing it wasn't going anywhere. And, you know, there was controversial stuff in Congress that you'll never hear because he would have an amendment that would embarrass the heck out of the people who are trying to pass, you know, very arbitrary laws. The amendment would never pass, but I think that also fed his spirit, and that is, to draw on people's consciences and say, look, you're not ready for this because the powers that be are never going to accept it, but you know it's the right thing. And I think Dad, you know, doing things because it was the right, fair, and just thing, even though it was not going to pass.
Was that his personality to, even though he was a person in power, to sort of speak truth to power, to challenge people in power, to get them to look at the world a different way than they might have?
I know he derived a lot of pleasure in making some people feel very uncomfortable. And that was good. I mean, whether it was, he would get in these huge fights that were losing fights, you know, with the head of the FAA and things like that, that you were never going to prevail, even though Lyndon Johnson was his friend, you know. But, I mean, Dad made a point and such and made people feel real uncomfortable. And sometimes you would succeed. I still remember, I forget who Dad was going after on something, and it was on the Financial Services Committee, and there was a cartoon, and it was Dad as Don Quixote, you know, with on a horse and a spear, and there's a windmill, and it shows Dad hitting the windmill, but the windmill is all falling and everything else. In other words, he was tilting at windmills, but once in a while, he could bring them down. And that's what he had done to this individual. It was just a wonderful cartoon, I always thought. I still remember that cartoon. So it didn't matter who it was. If Dad thought it was an illegal act or misfeasance, malfeasance in their duties, he called you on it. And I will say that he didn't let friendship get in the way of that. If you were his friend, Diego, and you and I, will have experienced this, you in public office, you will have friends that are going to let you down and may get in trouble, and you cannot support them. And people will say, well, what kind of friend were you? But he had the same standard for everyone. You know, I mean, you're honest, you know, if you're dishonest, he's not going to be with you. If you do an illegal act, he wasn't going to be with you. And I can think of two individuals that I love those guys. They were around our house for many years. They were Dad's biggest early supporters, but they got in trouble on some things that were very clear cut. There was no way of looking at it other than this is not good. You know, this wasn't something misspelled and some, you know, whatever it is. This was bad stuff. And so everybody knew, I mean, Dad would be a loyal friend to you. But he really expected you to maintain, you know, those standards.
By the way, I just want to point out to you guys that if we didn't have this opportunity, we wouldn't hear all this great stuff. I mean, it's really good stuff. Even though I'm asking all the questions, it's very therapeutic for me. As you can imagine, as a, you know, being who I am, the folks I represent, the party I'm in, being in the Texas legislature right now, you need stories of sort of courage and people being fortified and being comfortable upsetting people. But, you know, one of the things that happened to me in my first session was that I went in coming from city council. I had Julian with me, and we were sort of rocking and rolling. We were doing all kinds of great stuff. And then I go to the legislature, and, you know, it's a different environment. It's much more partisan. Seniority matters. I had none of those advantages. And I'm almost ashamed of how personally and emotionally affected I was in my disappointment in the way that some things turned out or votes that we lost or things that we couldn't stop from happening. And I know that that's not sort of the constitution of someone who is going to do this for a long while. So I'm working on that. This is the therapy part. But you also just told a story about him purposely filing bills that he knew were going to fail, purposely doing things that where he knew he was swimming upstream, and yet it was, not only was it important, but he enjoyed it. And just out of curiosity, can you remember a time on an issue, on a policy issue, where he was genuinely disappointed, where he really felt like there was something that he really wanted, and he, for whatever reason, it just didn't happen, and it left an impression, even if it was temporary, where he just said, that was rough.
And, you know, he was chairman of the Financial Services Committee, and major pieces of legislation on financial reform. But because you're in a body of 435, and you have a committee of 70 or whatever it is, and they're from all over, even on your side of the aisle, you know, and such. So I think he probably would have liked to have seen more far-reaching financial reform when it came to banks. And that wasn't going to happen. And so but he learned that you had to compromise. Now that's the other thing, is Dad wasn't it's all or nothing. On certain issues, it had to be all or nothing, but I'm just talking on piece of legislation. He understood you had to cobble it together. You had to bring in the Republicans. You had to bring in Democrats. You know, you had Wall Street Democrats. There are people from New York that are Democrats, right? It's a Democratic city for the most part. And so I think that there was a measure of disappointment there because he really wanted to do some things that were never going to really happen.
Right.
But they passed a piece of legislation that was an improvement on the situation. And that was the bottom line. And Dad was not going to compromise principle. But the legislative process, Diego, you learn. I mean, you've got 150 reps, and you have committees, and it's seniority, and you're in the minority in more than one way.
Right.
And it's a horrible existence because you can become irrelevant. And you have to then learn to work within that system. And you can be hard-headed, and you don't get things. But sometimes you just have to stand your ground and lose something of value at that moment because you just can't compromise on that.
Right, there's a line that you just can't.
Yeah, I mean, I never. Now, staff will hate you for it because they work so hard and you're this close to getting your amendment submitted and voted on and passed. And then, so a real quick example, and you're going to run into these things, and it's horrible. So there was no way any Democratic amendment was getting in the committee that I served on. But I had a great amendment. And I had a co-sponsor from Oklahoma, Republican. And it was great. And it looks like the chairman's going to let it, you know. And so, but suddenly we get something from chief counsel on the Republican side. And they said, look, we're going to pass your amendment. The chairman's going to let us have a vote on it, but you're going to have to vote against Congressman Stupak's amendment, a fellow Democrat. And I thought, but it's Stupak's amendment's a good amendment. So no, we need some votes on it. You're just going to trade. I said, I'm not going to do that. I mean, you know, I'm just not going to do that. And so my staff went nuts because it would have been one of the few amendments we ever got passed in that dang committee. But how could I vote against Bart Stupak's amendment? Right. That kind of a trade. And from the dais, the chairman basically looked at me and says, well, do we have an understanding? And I just, wow, you know, man. And I said, we do not. And that was the end of it. And so, I mean, but that would have been like, a moment. My dad did that on a grand scale. I did it in an amendment in a subcommittee. But that's the kind of stuff. But his whole life was characterized by taking stands like that and saying, no, you know, what I'm offering is on its merits. Don't go over there and try to deal. But you're going to learn, Diego, that in a big legislative body, and especially where you have leadership that appoints you to committees and stuff, they want a team player. They want a team player. And I'm going to say it now, but Dad was not a team player. And that's a that can be a liability in a big legislative body.
Yeah, I mean, I think that for me, one of the things that we're trying to constantly sort out, a constant conversation you have with yourself is, you know, you've got your principles, and part of your principles means that you spend your time kind of wagging your finger at the other side when they do things you don't like. But then you've got your legislative agenda, the package of bills that you want to pass that, you know, incrementally make things better for the people that you represent. But they also expect you to be a fighter, and they also expect you to play defense and stop certain things from happening, because some things that are proposed in Texas are probably not good for our community.
And no.
So I'm being diplomatic. So there's a balancing act between how vocal an opponent you want to be and getting your things passed. I guarantee if you're silent, the likelihood of these things passing goes way up. Right? If you participate in the larger body and are more of a voice and an opponent and a fighter, or even if you're just being what I call the Jiminy Cricket, if you're being the conscience of the House, the likelihood of your bills passing goes down. And so I'd like to believe there's a sweet spot we need to find, but it's not easy. But your comments segue into something really important to me, especially, and that is that I don't, you know, obviously, and I hope it's obvious, the legacy of your dad didn't end with your dad, but part of it is you and your career and the way that you approach it. I don't think that narrative is complete without including all the incredible work that you've done and what you stood for and what you continue to stand for. So I want to ask you about your career. Because without that conversation, we don't get a full picture of the contributions of your dad. After seeing him do all of that and go through all of that and not be around and throw those grenades and get beat up, why would you want to do this?
I often ask myself that after the fact. But no, I mean, that's the very reason you did it. It's the very reason I did it. It's because I saw that, and it was an incredible thing. Now, I knew I was going to go to law school, and I knew I was going to practice law. But then I wanted to be an elected official. I wanted to be, and so being a judge was the best of all worlds. I never thought that Dad, you know, that day would come that he wouldn't be in Congress, even though that, of course, the day would come that he's no longer in Congress. But I was around it, and I was just the right age to hang around with my father more than my brothers and sisters. My older brother and sister were getting in those teenage years where they had, you know, a new world. My younger ones were too small, but I was the one that was in the station wagon going to Austin when Dad was in the state Senate. I was the one going all over the state of Texas in a station wagon when he ran for governor and U.S. Senate. I mean, I still remember all those days, like, you know, we'd be driving all over with three mariachis in the back seat. And his press secretary with one of those little, remember the typewriters that were in those little cases and you'd open them? In a station wagon. And then, of course, you know where I was with the baggage in the back over there and stuff. And then I read where Dad's opponent was flying in a private airplane, a little airplane. And I thought, we're going to lose. Ain't no way we're going to win this one. But to see that, and the hopes and aspirations of people, Diego, and things are bad today. But I don't want to even tell you what they were like in the mid and late 50s.
Tell us a little bit.
Oh, you're talking about poverty and discrimination that was institutionalized, legalized. There was no joke about segregation here. I'm talking about not just African Americans, but the Latinos. You know, there was a school for the white kids, there was a school for the brown kids. As a matter of fact, right where I live. Now, you know, you had Gonzalez Elementary and you had Maverick. What was that about, you know? And of course, my parents just decided that we wouldn't go to either. We wouldn't go to Travis or Hawthorne. We went to Our Lady of Sorrows, which was a Catholic school, and it was just pretty interesting, especially when the fourth and fifth grade were together. It was a private education, but it lacked many things. I often think, like, my brothers and sisters went to public schools, and I went to Edison at the end, but it was just to follow in Dad's footsteps, and this is really, really bad. If I always tell the stories, Diego's, and I was the beneficiary of his good name, and that opened doors, like, you know, opportunities, because, so they would be interviewing people when I was running in 1998, and there were seven of us running, and there were some really great qualified people. Maria Versalada, Christina Hernandez, Walter Martinez. That's just, you know, hey, you had people that had been, you know, Commissioner's Court, the Dean of the State House, and Maria, who came within a few hundred votes of being mayor. I mean, you know, these were, you know, really incredible people, and a bunch of others. But I did have my father's name, so that was a great advantage. The disadvantage is that you can never live up to it, you know, but I had his name. And so when they would interview people, I didn't even have a name. They would just, who are you voting for? And they'd say, El Hijo. Okay, you know, that's fine with me. And so when I got to Congress, there were other children of members. Roy Ball Allard, Lucille, her father was my dad's colleague, Congressman Roy Ball. But there were others, Lacey Clay, I mean, on the Udalls, on and on and on. So I was talking to Lacey Clay. That's his middle name, is Lacey. That wasn't his father's first name. But he wanted his own identity. His father's leaving Congress. He runs, but he really is junior. So I said, you know, Lacey, do you ever have a problem following your dad's footsteps when you're out there campaigning and they're always comparing you to your dad? He says, oh, man. And it was just like I would say, and he said, I didn't even have a name. They would ask, who are you voting for? And they'd say, Junior. And I go, oh. I said, El Hijo, Junior, I understand. I understand. So we had that, but we were always being measured by our father's voting record, personalities and stuff. And you're a different person. You know, Dad raised us to be pretty independent, right? And when you asserted that independence, you know, he wasn't real happy about it. As a parent, you know, you say, do your own thing and everything else, and then you don't follow their advice, and then you get on your kids. You know, why are you following my advice and being so independent? So it was a great decision. I had seen all those wonderful things Dad had done, and I thought I could really do the job anyway, and it was time. I had been a judge for about 14 years, and the opportunity was just great, and I'll never regret it. But it was really uphill. And then because I look like my father, everybody there in Washington that served with Dad, I was called Henry more than you can believe. You know, hi, Henry. I didn't even correct them. And one last one, because it was an embarrassing moment for me. I had just gotten elected, and my good friend, who's a lawyer, was the U.S. attorney, Bill Blagg. We played baseball together. I love Bill Blagg. We played baseball. We did everything together. And he comes up, and it's my first year. You got to remember, when I was getting there, they had just voted on articles of impeachment, a trial in the Senate, and Chairman Hyde of the Judiciary Committee was internationally known. And so Bill Blagg and I are having lunch in the members' dining room, and he's the U.S. attorney now. He's my buddy and everything. And here comes Chairman Hyde. I don't know Chairman Hyde. I just gotten there, right? And so Bill goes, oh, my God. There's Hyde. There's Chairman Hyde, the guy I see on TV. So I have to act like I know everybody. I go, yeah, it's Chairman Hyde, Judiciary Committee. Oh, crud, he's walking towards us. He says, do you think you can introduce me? And I'm going, oh, man. So the chairman's coming by, and I go, good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. He goes, hi, Henry. And Bill Blagg looks at me like,
That's not so bad. When I got to city council, I mean, it's so small, everybody knows everybody. When I got to the legislature, people kept asking me which rep I worked for. Who's your rep? This guy, but no. Oh, yeah, he's new, right? Yeah. I totally get and understand that you're your own person. You want to do your own thing. But I do suspect that the things that you cared about were also informed by watching your dad work. And so what were the things in your time there that you cared about what were, what were the things you made priority? You said, look, I've got this district, here are these communities, here's what they're expecting of us. You know, I've got to take these two or three issues. I think it's usually we have two or three that we really focus on, and others that we just vote well on. What were the ones that you cared most about?
Well, you know, I mean, the first thing you care about in any member of Congress is the economic vitality of your district. And so you're going to identify your major employers, right? You are going to listen to them, and you should, because they provide a lot of jobs for a lot of people. And if you help them, they maybe will listen to you when you're talking about the needs of your constituents that happen to be their employees. So that it, I always found that really kind of easy, identifying what are the needs of your district just by looking at the economics. And then education, working with your educators. God, that was incredible. I mean, and it was a joy to work with the educators. I mean, you couldn't get a more dedicated group of individuals. So it really just came down, you know, what we're in them and protecting our military, because we still have a huge military investment in San Antonio. So those were, and really, it wasn't all that difficult. Now, there were issues that came up that I learned from Dad. And a lot of them had to do with, you know, our military policy. And, you know, my father, I think, and I believe this, even though I know that I've seen memos prepared for him on the Vietnam War, that Dad did not oppose the Vietnam involvement to the degree that he saw the dangers of it, you know. And that was not to take anything away from military families and the soldiers that were following these orders to go there. And so when I got there, I was just always real conscious of, like, no matter what, because we're Military City USA, and you got, you know, you just, we have this incredible pride, as we should have. But when, let's say, the invasion of Iraq and such, you know, there were only about 134, 138 of us that voted no. The entire Congressional Hispanic Caucus, which numbered maybe 20, all voted against it. And we have a lot of veterans there because they had not made their case. And so I would think that, you know, sitting there and going, if Dad was listening to this argument by Condoleezza Rice and Cheney and Rumsfeld and everything else, well, I'm afraid he probably would have called for impeaching everybody. But, you know, what would he do? And I did at times say, you know, what would Dad do in a situation like that? Because these were huge, huge issues. Right. And so, you know, he was always going to be a guiding light, and you took hard votes, and you could get criticized, but in a way, I think Dad did a lot of that, and he wore that as kind of his red badge of courage. And so, it was, but it still made it tough, though, Diego, on a lot of issues, because, like on I was on the banking committee initially, because Dick Ephardt just said, you're going to be on it. Your dad was chairman. You should be on it, which was very difficult because I'd be sitting there and there was a big portrait of my father behind me, like looking over me. And then what? And he's like this in the picture, I think. And my staff said, don't do that pose like that when you're. I mean, it's kind of weird. You're going, I'm paying you for that. But there were issues, and they would, and people would say, you know, your dad would never vote it that way. And I used to say, maybe you didn't know Dad very well. Right. There were very few, but and there were some votes that I think mine were different than Dad's. I do think that
it's still a good guiding light. Like you guys, I could do this all day. We've done this a couple of times privately, but it's a real honor to do it in public. You know, I look to you and your family as examples on how to do this the right way. I actually believe, and you know, I'm a little bit of a not nice person. He knows this. I'm much harder on my other elected colleagues in any level of government. I think we all could be doing a lot more if we took the fortitude and the strength and the courage and the real lack of being afraid to get unelected because you're going to do the right thing. If all of us did that, we could really move the city and the state to a better place very quickly. I think there's too many of us sort of playing it safe right now, and that's sort of my own frustration, is that, you know, I don't believe, and I'll close with this, and then I want to take questions. I don't believe, even though it's Hispanic Heritage Month, I don't believe that the legacy for me of your father and your family, you, is that there are a bunch of brown people sitting in office. Like, that's not what we aspire to. I think we aspire to people who are really there and spending their time working, sacrificing to make the lives of the people we represent better. And that takes courage, that takes determination, that takes a sort of fearlessness that I think is lacking compared to when you were in office and to when your dad is in office. And so I like that we've brought that story back out, because I hope it acts as a reminder to folks that we're here to serve people. And that doesn't mean just the sort of pageantry and show pony part, but that's actually to do work and do things that are risky. Because only the risky things that get us anywhere, that's a different place than we are now.
But think in terms, real quick, so I'm going to say something about Diego, and he knows how I feel about this, because we have had these discussions and the frustration of the system and legislative process and such, and when you take stands and... But, you know, you took an incredibly courageous stand when you were in the city council with your non-discrimination ordinance. You were way ahead of your time. But you see that play today, and you see people back off. And I know that people have some legitimate concerns, fears, and things about things and all that. But you knew it was the right thing to do. And the truth was, it could very well have cost you your position, because of the way the opposition was coming at you, but you've already had a Henry B. experience. Well, you know, you just need a...
I actually found it very liberating. So for those of you who don't know, during that time there was a very concerted effort to kick me out of office, to get me out of office. They're going door to door, knocking on people's doors, like, oh, do you know that Diego wants to let grown men into little girls' bathrooms? And they were trying to collect signatures to get me out of office. And they were also protesting in front of my field office every day, including Sundays, for 6 straight weeks. And so I faced this idea that I may lose my seat in a very ugly and public way. And then I realized that, and I remember thinking about the community and the people that we represent, and visiting the guys and women who work, you know, in the kitchen, in the banquet, or work in the press at the paper. If the biggest problem in my life is losing an election, my life is awesome. That's a good life, right? You're healthy, you know, you're educated. I had a fiance who's now my wife at the time. Everything was good. And so I think that I found that for a lot of elected people, the most important thing, the most precious thing in their life is their seat. And a lot of the decisions they make are made based on whether or not they get to keep their seat, which means that the needs of people is at best second, right? So the NDO was great for me, because now it's like, I'm gonna do what I think is right, and if it gets me out of office, well, then you can send me back to my life of making music and money and babies, and that's okay. So I appreciate that very much. But look, you guys, I don't think that you're ever going to get a real sort of snapshot like we did tonight. I mean, you're hearing things that you probably didn't know, and perspectives that you hadn't heard before, and that's incredibly valuable. It made it very, very rich. But if you've got questions, this is the time to ask. And don't be shy. Yes?
Yeah, this is a question to Congressman Gonzalez, you know. Again, when I, you know, number one, I was very, very blessed to have had the opportunity to meet the gentleman. You know, I was just a first grader at Navarro, and we were outside, and then all of a sudden this tall gentleman, you know, surfaces, and your dad, always beautiful suit, you know. And it's just like, you know, Christmas already, you know. He was so articulate, he was so, you know, he always had a smile on his face, you know. And then the key thing that really impacted, you know, that blew me away was that he was out there, ¿cómo estás? Like, he's proud to be bilingual, you know. And I'm like, you know, hey, that's a very special gentleman, you know. But my question goes to the little that I know about your brother, I mean, father, rather, is that at one time he was a boxer, or he was an amateur boxer, and then from there he goes to public servant. So my question is this. We're talking about a gentleman, very articulate, has charisma, who were those influential individuals? His parents, our grandparents, our others? Can you help us with that? Because some, whenever you look at a great person, the gentleman or the young lady is great, but there's others that really, drove them toward that direction, toward public service.
Well,
who were those special people?
And Gene may, because Gene wrote that incredible thesis that touches on influences. In my opinion, it really was Dad's home life and the history of coming over from Mexico. And his father, of course, was the editor of La Prensa. So he came from a really wonderfully rich cultural life and an appreciation for reading and education. I think that Dad was really influenced by everything that he read. And he had romantic notions of things, and that's why that thing with Don Quixote I thought was so dang good, because he loves Cervantes, of course. But I think it was really more than anything else is the lessons that he learned by just his appetite for learning and reading. And of course, injustice. It's so easy to know something so unfair, And if you were Mexican-American at that time, it was real clear what was happening in this city, and to some degree, lesser, but still, is happening today. So I think that's what it was. And he just had real supportive, he had an incredibly supportive brother and sister, too. That would have given up their careers for Dad. And that's pretty incredible.
What were the offices your father ran for? We always think of him as the congressman and representative, but you all of a sudden mentioned, oh my gosh, I can't imagine he failed at something.
Oh.
So what was the totality of offices he ran for?
Well, again, Gene can tell you, people forget that Dad lost his first race because he ran for state rep and he lost.
But he got in the runoff. His first race in 1950, at that time, it was run countywide. There were no single member districts. And he had urged several people to run because he felt time was right. Because a couple of years before that, in 48, there was a coalition of blacks and Latinos in Bexar County that elected Gus Garcia to the school board, the Senate school board, and G.J. Sutton to the Alamo College, now it's Alamo College District. They ran together, and they won. And it was a coalition of Hispanics, Latinos, Mexicanos, blacks, and working whites, working people from Southside and all over. And they were able to win. It surprised everybody that they were able to win. So he felt that there was a chance to run and win in the state house. And he urged several people to run, and they laughed at him. A Mexican can't win, they told him. And one of them told him, well, if you think a Mexican can win, why don't you run? And of course, that's all he needed to do for Henry is challenge him, right? He said, okay, I will. And he did, he had learned early on in his career, when he was the juvenile probation officer, the chief probation officer, he learned how to talk to the media, for example, in sound bites and colorful phrases. And for example, when he was the juvenile probation officer, he said, we're going to change the way this office operates. Right now, the office requires the parents and the child to come to the office. We're going to go to the homes, right? So the time he was there for about 4 years, he visited himself 10,000 homes, right? 10,000 homes that he visited. When the county judge, who was his boss, said, you cannot have that black woman office in the courthouse, he said, nobody's going to tell me how I can office my staff. He officed her there. He clashed with the judge, and he resigned as a result. But it was public knowledge throughout the whole city, and he gained a lot of support. He was also very articulate, as we've said, both in English and Spanish, and he was well known as an MC, right? At various dances and weddings and social clubs. Everybody wanted Henry B., he was not an elected official, to be the MC. Because he knew how to introduce people and how to acknowledge people and so forth. So he, you know, he had a following. He was also very active as the education director for the Ladies Garment Workers Union. Right? So he had labor support. He taught mathematics at Lanier for veterans. So he was fairly well known. So when he ran, he paired up with Maury Maverick Jr. Right? And they ran not as on the same ticket, but as a team. So they helped each other. They both got in a runoff against, at that time, the state legislature was controlled, as those of you from San Antonio know, by a small group out of the north side, mostly all members of the San Antonio Country Club. But they ran together and they both got in the runoff. And Maury won in the runoff and Henry B. lost by just a little bit. But Maury, when he won, the first thing he said, he would not have won without Henry's support. So he lost that race, but he got well known and he learned how to run. Remember, he had to run countywide, so he knew he had to have a coalition. So then in 53, when there was a lot of turmoil on city council, and a group wanted to organize a ticket, they asked him to run and he agreed. And he ended up winning. In fact, I think he won by the most votes. And he was elected mayor pro tem by his colleagues at the very beginning.
But the races that he ran and lost, they ran. Then in 58, he decided he would run for governor.
Right.
And of course, Price Daniel was one of the most popular. Of course, that had its differences with him. Lost. It was a statewide race, and of course he was going to lose, but he was making a statement, and I didn't think deep down he thought he was really going to win. And then with Lyndon Johnson.
But for the governor's race, of course he had been in the filibuster and got statewide attention, right? So he was also speaking all over the state. So he ran, and they asked him, "Why are you running?" Well, Price Daniel was running, who was a sitting governor, but the former governor, Pappy Lee O'Daniel. Decided to run, and Pappy Lee O'Daniel was had a swing band, you know. Then he used to, in these flatbed trucks, he'd go, and he was sponsored by a biscuit company, so they'd call him Pappy, Pass the Biscuits O'Daniel, right?
That's true.
So the reporter asked Henry, "Why are you running? You can't win." He says, "Well, I wanted to give the people a choice. Right now, all their choices between Tweedledee and Old Tweedledee."
Dad had classic lines in when he ran for, well, first 58, he loses to governor. He runs in 61 because Lyndon Johnson is now vice president. And Dad actually did, it would have been 61. What was
61.
61. And then he runs for Congress because Congressman Kilday was appointed to the Military Court of Appeals or something, and it opened up. Otherwise, you know, who knows what would have happened. But there, all the stories of Dad's one-liners are great. And I remember in your paper, Gina, so Dad is debating, I guess it was for Congress, and I think John Good may have said something, called him a creeping communist or something.
Yeah.
And Dad, what did Dad say? The only thing creeping.
The only thing creepy about me are my shorts.
I mean, this was like live TV in those days.
He also called him a left winger. He said, "Well, I'm a pitcher, and I'm
pitch right-handed." Yeah, pitch right-handed. So, it's classic stuff. I mean, you couldn't make it up, right?
Let's take the next question.
By the way, he did come in second in the governor's race. He beat Pappy Lee.
Yeah, he did, in the Doughboys, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
We're living in an era where there aren't too many politicians out there that we have respect for. In our district, we really respect our man Bernal because he's done such a beautiful job in Austin. Going to all the different schools in our district is just wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if we still had Henry B. around, what would he tell us during this time?
Well, you know, and the sad thing is I don't think that could have survived in the political environment in modern campaigns. I mean, with, of course, I also think, though, Twitter, Dad would say, wait a minute, I can get all of how many people? but he wanted to see everything. He wanted to touch everything. He wanted to sign everything. He wanted to communicate with you. He wanted to put a PS. How's your Aunt Isabel doing? I mean, that's the way he was. But I guess electronically, but it would be campaign finance, for instance, the redistricting wars and things like that. I'm just not sure that would have been an environment. And then Congress, because of gerrymandering and things, I don't know. I mean, he would be saying things that definitely would be headlines because he'd have such a clever way. I mean, can you imagine this, the material Dad would have on, you know, with Donald Trump? I mean, God, he could go on a speaking tour, you know. But I think he would have had some really wonderful observations, and how he would have functioned, I'm not real sure that the modern Congress has room for people like that anymore. And that's sad.
That is sad. Mm-hmm. Other questions? Yes.
Yes, I admired Henry Z for pretty much his part. I maybe even voted for him a time or two all those years ago. He did stand up for every single little guy, downtrodden minority that there was, except one, the unborn child. Sadly, I think he voted pro-abortion whenever that legislation crossed his desk. I was sorry to see and hear that later on.
Is there a question, Jeff?
No, just a comment.
Dad's position was a difficult one, because if you knew his mother, and the devout Catholic that she was, and if you knew his relationship with San Fernando, I mean, and it was tough. But Dad always understood that there had to be a separation. And the things trouble you, but for Dad, it really was respecting the views of everyone. And if the courts, because in the final analysis, you know, the court determined certain things, the constitutionality of the laws that my father would be passing and such, and they had been ruling for some time on this. And so, I mean, I think Dad was just a real believer in the separation of church and state, great believer in checks and balances, and everything that the Constitution he believed, and it would be very unpopular on some things, but you didn't like the law, you try to change it, but the courts eventually...
And the story you told earlier about the way that you had come down on the side of principle as opposed to friendship, I think is a good example of that, where it's about the principle, it's about what's right and wrong, and your sort of personal feelings can't make their way into those conversations. Other questions? Sure, let's go back here and then you... Go ahead.
Me not being here from, not being from San Antonio, I never had, I guess I could take that upon myself, but I haven't had the pleasure to learn, you know, about the history of Henry B. Gonzalez or all the great things he's done for our city. Right now that I work for an elected official, I know a lot of the things that we do, or some of the things we do are modeled after the way he did things. And I wanted to ask, what are some of the things that he did specific to him as far as constituent services, stuff like personally signing the letters or other things like that? What would those things be?
I think that it's just, first of all, you know, you're elected official that, you know, you work for that individual. You are the face of that individual. And Dad always impressed on everybody is that when people hear you speak, they're hearing me speak. So the first, he started off with having an incredibly loyal, dedicated, and smart staff. That understood how important, but he also made sure that they felt that they were rewarded, maybe not financially, because, you know, that's not the kind of budget those offices have, as you already know, and Diego knows. So I think it started there, but it was the door was, and he used to have a sign. He was the first one that had that sign on the door. This office belongs to the people of the 20th district. It just wasn't a sign. He really meant it. And anybody could come in there and they could even hate him, call him an SOB or whatever it is. But that he, that office belonged to the person that thought my dad was an SOB. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just the way it was. And so I think that was just this whole dedication that everyone should have a voice. If I disagree, doesn't mean I have to vote a certain way in the legislature or in Congress just because someone is screaming and yelling and disagreeing with me. I'm going to do what I think is for the collective good of my district and the people. But I really think it was instilling in his own staff the importance of respect for an individual. And I still remember, I mean, because I, and you know this, Diego, and because you always have to tell staff, is that there's a certain amount of abuse that you're just going to take. You know, I mean, and that, and you can't get discouraged, you can't get angry, and you still have to help that person. As much as you're helping that wonderful person that's bringing you fresh baked goodies and stuff like that. Because in Dad's eyes, you know, they're all citizens, they're all your constituents, and they're looking to you. And to this day, I have a lot of people who come up, you know, from the real established, more wealthy families, and they go, never agreed with your dad, you know, but I respected him because he was honest and he was hardworking. I got to leave you one last story because this was like, it's an eye-opener. When you finally leave office, first of all, you don't get invited to a lot of stuff anymore. So I leave Congress and I need a key made. And so there's this little place off Vance Jackson and they make keys. And so I go in there and I go, you know, I need three copies. And so the man makes three copies. I said, how much is that? He says, it's on me. And I go, God, wow. First of all, I'm not in Congress anymore, so I probably can accept that.
Right.
This guy, he must think I just did a great job. I was a good congressman. He's saying thank you. And I said, but sir, let me introduce myself. I know who you are. Now I really know. This guy has something great. So I said, let me pay. No. On me. I said, sir, please let me pay. He says, no. I never voted for you. I feel guilty. I still go there, and now it charges me. You really said that to me. So whenever you start getting that big head, and you think you're really, you know, cool, and people love you, they'll bring you back down to earth.
I want to get the one. Someone else had a question. We'll close with this question.
But that was such a good closing story. I was just thinking about as a child. And after you mentioned Diego said he had people marching around his office. And when your dad, or like, I'm thinking he probably had enemies. Were there times as a child when you were scared, literally, like when they integrated the swimming pools or something? Was that?
Yeah, because it got, you know, there were violent people. And of course, you know, what year was that Chevrolet? He had a Chevrolet and he had it painted a couple of times. So either red or white at some point. And there was a bullet hole because, you know, people shot at the house and the car and stuff. So, I mean, it was serious. I mean, we used to have police come and, you know, they'd be out there guarding the house or whatever it is. And Dad was very proud. You know, he would say, my name, my address, and my phone number are in the phone book. You remember phone books, right? And we as kids, we'd go, you're never home. We're the ones catching hell. And so my poor mother would always have to answer the phone, and it would be, you tell that SOB husband of yours. Yes, yes, okay, thank you. And it was poor mom that had to be answering the phone and getting all the abuse and the people carrying the stuff in front of the house. But he did have actually some really powerful enemies. But those aren't the ones that were yelling at you. And the problem with Dad, though, is that he could get, you know, I mean, if you challenged him, he wasn't scared to mix it. And that was, I think that scared us the most. Don't do that because, I mean, if you threaten him and you come at him, that he would, and that, I think we always felt as kids that probably was the greatest danger, was that Dad was not going to, as they say, take any lip from somebody and all that. But I'm telling you, I remember we were coming back from Austin one day. We were on Broadway. In the old days, you would get Hillebrand, take a left on Broadway, and get on Austin Highway. Remember that? Okay. So we're coming back near Incarnate Word, and a car stops next to us, and Dad, and you can tell that this guy's giving Dad the bad eye or something. And Dad rolls the window down, you know. And so the guy motions his wife, who's in the passenger seat, to roll the window down. And so my dad, it's like, I felt like saying, Dad, you're acting like me. You know, you're acting like a 14-year-old here. Hey, what you looking at? You know. And so Dad told him, excuse me, you have something. And so they started arguing right there. I mean, it was horrible. It was horrible. And I thought, God, this is worse than hanging around with my buddies. And I thought, yeah, we're going to get beat up or something. But no, I mean, that was the thing, is Dad was like, you're in his face. You know, he just was like that. People admired it, and I mean, and you can understand some of that, but I think that was our greatest fear. And people, yeah, they were a lot of threats, a lot of them.
That, though, is a great story, and a great moment to end. Guys, thanks so much for being here and witnessing this. It was an honor for me, and I feel like we all learned a lot. So thank you guys so much. And,
thank you.